Hello, and thank you for tuning in to the Final Draft Write On podcast. I'm Pete D'Alessandro, your host and product manager here at Final Draft. This is the screenwriting podcast where we talk about all things filmmaking. Kim Nguyen is a writer and director whose past films include War Witch and Marsh. Today, Kim will be telling us about his new feature film, The Hummingbird Project, starring Alexander Skarsgård and Jesse Eisenberg. Kim Nguyen, welcome to Write On.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
Glad to have you. Let's talk about how you got started in storytelling. I know Marsh was the first feature film. How did you get into storytelling in general?
Well, I just generally was drawn to writing stories from the moment I was in my teenage years. Seems so long ago. I told myself I should write a feature film pretty early on, and I read some Sid Field, and I read this book called The Screenwriter's Workshop, I think, and just got to writing a first draft, and over the years tried to kind of learn to get away from preconceived structure modes such as Sid Field and be more in tune to my own instincts.
So then what happened first? What did you start doing?
I wrote a love story, which was probably a little bit on the nose if I had it read today. And yeah, it was about this doctor who fell in love with a woman who was on the spectrum, I think. Yeah. I should read it back.
We'll get an audio excerpt for that later, for sure.
Sure.
So what happened then? How did you start building a career? How did you start getting involved into real storytelling and long-form storytelling?
I heard in an interview Harrison Ford saying that the way he went into the business was he kept a sideline job until he would have enough offers to pick the right roles that were for him on a, you know, daily basis. So I think he was a woodworker, a high-end woodworker. So I decided to stick to teaching as I was developing projects for my first feature and then when this got made, I decided to, you know, it was time to move on to just doing directing and writing.
So we're all about the directing and writing here. So what was it like to get that first feature together? How did that start happening?
It was strange. So The Marsh is a weird, I guess it adheres to the magic realism genre, and it tells the tale of two Eastern European people who are kind of rejected from a village, and they live close to a marsh, and weird things start happening, and there's a murder, and they get blamed for it because they're different. And yeah, so I thought I was going to do this film for only $200,000 and just like hurry and just film my first feature. And it turned out, weirdly enough, that the script got some interest from producers who had more experience than me, and they said, no, we'll get you a little bit more money. So I got a fairly good amount of funding for a first feature. I think I got $1.5 million, something like that.
Wow.
And the film got made. I'm saying this as if it happened overnight, but it was, you know, like a two-year process or something like that.
2 years is overnight for the most part.
Yeah, it's true.
So how does that segue into the rest of your career?
I think that most people, when they watch my different films, they say that I have an eclectic kind of approach to film. Each of my stories are very different. I think that more and more what I kind of cling to is this kind of realism that touches on a little bit of the surreal, but yet it's still based on real facts and real stuff. And with characters that kind of have a yearning for something, and you try to kind of drag them through the mud as through your storytelling, and they kind of struggle to climb out of that mud. And the Hummingbird Project is literally that: is this guy who goes through swamps and lakes and rivers and digs a tunnel. And I guess in some way the swamps and the forests of the movie end up being kind of like a quest of within. He's struggling through his inner swamps and forests.
That struggle is ugly and brutal, and it's just about digging some pipe. I mean, there's so much to have to work with. So let's talk about Hummingbird Project. How did you first get involved with this story?
I was concerned about how, and I still am concerned about how, the financial system is influencing our society. I find that our global economy, there's something wrong about the way it's going. I don't know if there ever was a period where everybody said, oh, the economy is going well and it's perfect. But I do find that there's some some stuff about the underground life of this that we kind of lost track of and that we're not aware of. So that being said, I was trying to find a story that would talk about the madness and the irrationality of the whole thing. But I didn't want to do a film that took place in a single room in a, you know, in a trading room. So I let it simmer a little bit in the back of my head. And then I read up about how all these people are kind of working on infrastructures, digging stuff and building towers to shave a single millisecond off of the times of their transactions and try to make millions off of that process. And I thought that was really madness. And that's kind of how the story came about. It's the story of these two cousins who try to dig a 1,000-mile-long tunnel between a stock market that's established in Kansas and the New York Stock Exchange, and by doing so, hope to shave one single millisecond off of their transactions.
And it's such an important logistical concern and a real story driver that this has to be a straight line. Can you talk about that? How did that come together?
From what I've read and from some what people have done in the past, is like, what's important to how do you shave a millisecond off your transactions is you try to make a straight line instead of a line that takes curves around mountains and rivers. So that's why it gets so mad, is that whatever things that you have to go through, you just dig and explode and make mountains explode and dig under rivers. So that's how mad it is. But maybe I'm not answering your question. Can you repeat your question again?
I guess I'm trying to think about how did the logistics of it are perfect. And I really appreciate the, I mean, just the background and how this has to be a straight line, but how did that come together as a plot device?
Oh yeah. Well, I guess that, as I was doing research, what I thought was interesting about that line is that it's just as much the outside line of building that thing as eventually the inner line, the lifeline of this character, you know, what is he yearning for? And it kind of get mixed up through the script. And I had a producer who told me that what he thought was interesting about the story is that it's a story built with double irony, meaning that what the character thought he was yearning for and what we tell the audience we were yearning for eventually becomes twisted and it becomes something else. And it's like a journey from an outward journey that transforms into a journey within. It's this guy who thinks that he thinks that his objective are the right ones, and it's similar to some kind of perverted American dream. And eventually he kind of realizes that that's not what it's all about, and he tries to find out what it should be about.
What is it in the end? I mean, what is it about for him?
I guess he's still trying to understand, but there's a relationship to time, is that we have a limited time on this earth, and whether you made billions or millions or $100 in your life, in the end, we all end naked and decomposing in some place on the ground, you know?
Right.
In the end, it doesn't mean a lot.
Right.
If you made billions or millions.
Life is measured in milliseconds and hummingbird flaps.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Let's keep talking about your writing process and how we get into nice details here about how you write and about how you wrote this. How did you start? What's the process like at the very beginning?
Your audience are like screenwriters and stuff like that. They won't get bored if I thought we go into details of stuff, right?
No, we go into deep details here, so feel free.
Okay. Initially, I would very much work in a three-act structure written down on paper and follow that through like a dogma and almost define the ending in a very static way before starting to write. And over the years, I've been writing for now almost 20 years, more than that, 25 years. That's crazy. That's insane.
Yeah.
It's more than half my life. So over the years, that sense of three acts has become more of a kind of like as if you're listening to music, in the sense that I don't necessarily write it out. I have a sense of keeping a rhythm and a structure. And I find the music, talking about a script, writing it as if you're writing a piece of music is something that's very pertinent. And so the three act structure keeps morphing as I write from one scene after the other. And I try to write the first draft very, very quickly. Well, for me, it's very quickly, but within, you know, 5 or 6 weeks, I try to get a first draft out.
Wow.
Maybe sometimes it's going to be 8 weeks, but
it's usually considered to be fairly fast unless you're working in television. I'm talking in feature film schedules.
Of course.
But then I do substantial amount of rewrite. One, within those 8 weeks, one thing that's important is the first 25 or 30 pages. That's where I usually stop and reread what I did, what doesn't make sense at all, and then I kind of reimagine the following 70 or 80 pages. It usually transforms what was my heading, what I expected that the film where the film would go.
So what did you change in those first 20, 25 pages in Hummingbird?
Oh, that's very interesting. I don't know if I would remember. I know that I know that if I can speak about another film I'm working on right now, I got so depressed at a certain point because at the second draft that I wrote, I got really, really good feedback from my colleagues who were reading the script. So I was really excited. So I started polishing it a number of drafts, and as I went, it almost felt like Groundhog Day, the movie. As I kept rewriting, polishing, and listening to people telling me that I should give more backstory to the lead character and set him up a little bit better, it got boring, and like the script was getting worse and worse. I was getting worse and worse feedback, and then I was telling that to my agent. He said, "Kim, the good draft was like draft two, so just go back to that." He was saying actually just send the second draft, but I did like just almost that is like keep the second draft as your structure, as your bone. Don't give backstory because I think that's what made people interested in the character, the fact that you don't resolve everything right from the first 10 pages of the script. And but go grapple at your draft that you did later on and fix the little things that didn't work like around the bone that's there. You know what I mean? And that was very liberating to me. In a way, it's what happens almost in every script for me. Do you hear that a lot?
Yeah, to an extent, there's a lot of people with different processes. Some people do that, 80-page treatment before they start writing a script.
Wow. Oh,
And
I could never do that.
no, I think that would be really hard for me
I'd be
personally.
exhausted.
And then I wouldn't be able to, I think that would be just as hard for me to steer and to kind of course correct.
Yeah, don't you find there's something about preserving your creative energy also? If you write
Yes.
too many treatments and too many one-liners and too that, I actually gone to the point where I can't afford it, but I can't afford not to afford it. I actually hire assistants to do. Sometimes, they need like a lookbook
Oh,
with
wow.
like with 5 or 10 pages. Because I'm the director also, sometimes most of the time that's like more asked of me, but I hire sometimes writers who I give them my first draft and I tell them to write a 3-4 page treatment off of that draft.
Wow.
Just to say, I find that preserving that creative energy is like, when you're drained even before starting to rewrite, that's so painful.
Right. Sometimes it's hard to just drag your feet off the line to start a rewrite.
Yeah, exactly.
And then I think you can definitely lose your way. So how do you stay focused on a rewrite? How many times are you going back to that well and trying again? How many notes are you getting and taking to implement?
I'm certainly taking too many notes from people. I think that's one of my flaws is I don't I try to, maybe it's the Canadian part of me of listening, of being nice. But yeah, I do like the blacklists, the website where you can just throw your script and get a general feedback within, a couple of days or about 2 weeks. But I do find that sometimes it can become like, okay, you're seeking people to, how do you call it in English? Sorry. You're looking to be accepted, it's instead of like listening to a good story. And I do feel that generally speaking, if you listen too much to the blacklist comments, there's a general sense of overexposition. And not, I won't say blandness, but at a certain point, it's the fact that it's not perfectly balanced that makes it a good script in a way. You have to find masterpieces. Most masterpiece films wouldn't necessarily have a 95% average on the blacklist because some people wouldn't like connect to it.
Sure, yeah. I mean, there would be that subjectivity, but yes, I guess you're definitely, as you're saying, I think skewing some of the perspectives if you're just getting that feedback.
Yeah, I think it's useful if you consider that it's just like advice among many. You know, it's good to
Right.
kind of like bouncing, like throwing. It's like a river that flows through rocks. You know, it's like it swerves a little bit, but you keep the heading or something.
Oh,
I
that's
don't know.
great. That's actually a great analogy, and that's just one rock.
Yeah.
There's a decent amount of sort of play back and forth between these characters. So I'm really thinking of Anton, and I'm forgetting Salma Hayek's character's name, but there's a lot of back and forth and play in there.
It's interesting because I've gone to a place where I had a little bit, very tiny amount of luxury where we all knew that the script was too long. But when you have many characters and you move from location to location and things are happening parallelly, I think it's cool if you can film like 130 pages of or 140 pages of fiction. And even if you know that you're going to try to achieve 110, 115 minute film, the thing is you don't know how which actor is really going to nail it and carry the film sometimes. It's like, for example, in our case, Michael Mando is a great actor and he really brought forward a lot of stuff to the film and we gave him more space on in the film. But if those scenes weren't written, we can't know. And for me, that's especially true in the final act of the final act. Like those 10 or 15 last pages, I tend to overscript the conclusions, meaning that I try to give each character some kind of, even if it's just like a one paragraph moment, kind of conclude him or her, that character, and just so that we filmed it. But most likely there will be only one or two persons that will get their like true conclusion. But it's important to film the conclusion of maybe the four or five most important characters, just to have a thing where you can say goodbye to them. Because what the worst thing is if you didn't film that and you missed that in the edit. Like, I think that the spectator feels cheated if he can't say one last goodbye to one of the characters. And, you know, he feels that it's really needed.
I think there is that nice sense of closure at the end of this. That's a really great point.
Oh, thank you. And that was a life. So for Hummingbird, we had about a 130-page script that was, thank God, Jesse could speak as if it was a 110 minutes film. But we also had one or two or three scenes, mostly in the end of the script, that we took out of edit that were over-conclusive in a way. But we knew that was going to be the process.
I mean, you prepare for that and you have more footage than you need. And do you run by test audiences? Do you look at those? Are you showing to friends?
We did do, in this case, we did do, I usually do screen tests, you know, with friends.
Mm-hmm.
For the first time for this film, we did a screen test with audiences before locking the picture.
Mm-hmm.
And it turned out to be very useful, actually. It turned out to be very useful. You kind of like, you're kind of wary of those things. But as long as it's like the producer's thing and he's open to just like listening, but not necessarily acting upon the reports. We actually got a lot of interesting feedback. Sometimes you take things for granted and 300 people say something or like 280 people out of 300 say something. You kind of tend to listen a little bit.
Right. You get that consensus and fresh eyes on it, obviously all that.
Mm-hmm.
What changed at that point for this?
Actually, I think that with the screen test in this case, we did a reshoot. I think it was after. So there was in the case of Hummingbird Project, there was something about we didn't necessarily nail what was the guy's background and why he's obsessed with that line. We kind of went straight to the Chinatown meeting initially. We felt that people needed to know that this guy wasn't already a riches trying to be more richer. He was kind of a guy who came from lower middle class revenue. And, you know, he's a typical New York and it really made the character more relatable. And it's weird because it's just that one single scene at the beginning of the film that wasn't in the script initially.
What was the feedback? Because that is a solution to a problem. But I don't think anyone in that test audience would have been like, well, you need a scene in the beginning with a, what was the feedback you actually got?
It was just like we did get a couple of comments, not knowing from where Anton from where Vincent came from, that, you know, well, where does this guy from? Why is he doing this? Is he doing this just to make more money when if he's working in the stock market, he's already probably making enough money. So we didn't give enough context of what was his social status. We had to make it clear that it was a rags to riches, and also that he was kind of like obsessed with this line in a almost on the spectrum way, you know. It wasn't just like he can't explain why he's doing what he's doing. So that makes him, I think, maybe more relatable, because I kind of relate to that. I, you know, I do, when I do films, sometimes at a certain point, you see people running and rushing, and you see you see stuntmen getting a little bit hurt, or, you know, like they got a little bit of glass on their forehead and there's a little bit of blood, and you wonder, okay, what's the purpose of what I'm doing? Why are we paying this person to get hurt and sign releases and all of that? So I guess that was part of that very first scene. It's weird how it's just one scene.
That's true. I mean, that really does set the tone for the movie. It really sets that character.
Oh, thank you.
So let's talk about, you know, wrapping this up. Two last questions. One, what was the biggest challenge in directing this?
Spontaneously, it's a boring answer, I think, but it's time. This and it's related to the film. But we had so little time. This was 70 more than 70 locations in this film, and it really was like a road movie.
Yeah.
But we had 20 ton machines to bring in the middle of forest. We had paths to open, we had like a Sikorsky helicopter. We had a 200 ton crane, and every single day we were moving the whole company of 60 caravans with, you know, three A-list actors. So in 32 days, we had 32 days to do this, and it was insane. It was really, really, really hard. I think that for my next films, it's so risky. You got to be on track at every single line, every single scene that you're filming, and you can't have any doubts. So I guess for the next film, it's, you know, also for the people who are investing in films, in my films, I need to ask them to give me more time.
Right.
See, it's exactly like in the film.
It really is. The same logistics they dealt with, you dealt with.
Yeah.
So last question, wrapping up. What is the piece of advice you would give yourself looking back, not just at Hummingbird, but at your career? What's the piece of advice you'd like to give the former version of yourself?
Oh, that's so interesting. It's so interesting. You know, it's going to be it's going to be a weird answer.
That's great.
I think that you should follow your voice, but also in a way be aware of how people perceive you in the choices you make for the films that follow. In the sense that I came from a place of where I did Warwitch, which is it's a hard, dark film. And I think that over the years, the press are still waiting for me to go back there, you know? So, and to make this dark movie. And sometimes you can kind of like lose them, and they're like, okay, but why did you do this? this film, well, where we want more violent film and socially involved films. I think all of my films are hopefully have social involvement, but there's that thing. I'm not saying it should make you change your choices of stories, but I think it's important to be aware of that as you're going through going from one film to the next. You know what, I'm saying that and I feel it's very specific to my trajectory. I don't know if it's useful for all filmmakers. Anyways, so it's
there's somebody out there who definitely will appreciate that, so for sure.
I hope so. Sorry, my colleague is telling me we need to wrap the interview. So thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. Thank you, Kim Nguyen. Thanks for being here.
Good luck for the rest of the week.
Yes, thanks.
All right. Take care.
Bye. And if you're hearing this, that means you're a much appreciated Right On listener. Join the other listeners who have left us those ratings and reviews on iTunes. You can stay in the know by following us on Facebook or find us on Twitter as Final Draft Inc., or on Instagram as @FinalDraftScreenwriting. I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Until next time, right on.